Welcome to this message by Ray Steadman titled, When You Come Together, from raysteadman.org. The text for this message is from 1 Corinthians 14, 26 through 40.
Now we come again to the 14th chapter of 1 Corinthians. As we're nearing the close of this great letter, we're still dealing with the church as it's come together and speaking now of many things concerning the functioning of the church. And this morning we will be discussing in this chapter the answer to a question many have asked today. When is the church really a church? Is it a church when it's gathered together like this on Sunday morning, or is it a church still when it's scattered out in the highways and the byways and the homes and the offices and apartments and shops? Is that still the church functioning there? You can get a lot of debate about that today. And if you think of the church, as many do, only as existing when it comes together on Sunday mornings or other times, you have to ask the question, well, how many people does it take to make a church? Jesus said, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. And that seems to me to constitute the very fundamentals of a church, so that even two or three Christians gathered together and thinking about the work of the kingdom of God is a church in action. Well, it's very hard to define a church, especially a local church in the New Testament concept. It's almost like nailing Jell-O to the wall. Every time you think you've grasped it, it slips between your fingers. But one thing I think is clear from the biblical account, and that is the early church met together. This was one thing that is very clear in the scripture. From the earliest times, Christians felt that urge to meet together and gather with brothers and sisters in the family of God and share together. And when you ask, what did they do when they met together? The answer, of course, is they began to minister to one another. They shared their spiritual gifts. They exercised what God had given them for the benefit of each other. And verse 26 of 1 Corinthians 14 describes that very procedure. What then, brethren, when you come together, each one has a hymn, a lesson, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. Let all things be done for edification. We don't have any knowledge of how large the church was at Corinth. Perhaps by this time, several years after it had begun, it was a considerable size. Possibly several hundred of people had become converted and were gathering here at Corinth. And if so, it was difficult perhaps to always allow everyone to have a part. In Jerusalem, we know that the early church shortly after Pentecost consisted of as many as 10,000 members. Now, obviously, they would have great difficulty finding a place to meet together with a church that large. And certainly, if they did, it would be impossible to let everyone have a hymn, a lesson, a revelation, or the exercise of their spiritual gift. And if they did, the meetings would probably still be going on, knowing how Christians tend to run on at times. But obviously, this verse describes a smaller home type of meeting where there was possible to have this kind of intimacy of sharing and this universality of participation. They seem to have then two types of meetings in the first century. One in which, as described here, people met together in a small, intimate gathering in which they could share with one another and exercise their spiritual gifts and all participate in the meeting. But also there were large, informally conducted meetings where preachers would preach and teachers would teach the whole of the body. And there would be attention given to one or two people, perhaps, exercising a spiritual gift to the whole body. You have such a meeting described in the 20th chapter of Acts, where the apostle in the city of Troas meets with all the Christians in that area. And you remember that famous meeting. It began probably around 9 o'clock at night, but Paul, it says, continued his speech until midnight. And that was the occasion when a young man went to sleep under the apostle Paul. Always been an encouragement to me. And you remember, fell out the window, and Paul had to exercise a restoring ministry in his life. This is why I've always appreciated the fact that the seats here are right on the ground level. We keep you as close to the ground as possible here at PBC. I don't have the gift of healing like Paul did. But in either type of ministry, either type of meeting, one thing was clearly evident. There was one purpose for getting together. Paul says it. Let all things be done for edification. Now, edification means more than simply teaching or instruction of the mind. The word is a larger word than that. It means to build people up. And getting together on Sunday morning here is an edifying thing. I was feeling it afresh this morning as we concluded that excellent singing. And there was a sense of excitement in our gathering here. What is it that brings you out on a rainy Sunday to fill this auditorium twice on Sunday morning? Well, it's the feeling of being built up, edified, instructed, encouraged, comforted, uplifted. And it does something for you, doesn't it? Starts the week out right. And cleanses away some of the cobwebs that have been gathering all through the week. And that's what the apostle is describing here. When Christians get together, this ought to be the aim of the meeting, that everything that's done contribute to the understanding of the mind and the uplifting of the spirit, the encouraging of the heart, and thus be an edifying process involving growth, understanding, exhortation to activity on the basis of an expectant attitude that God is going to be with you and working through you all through the week. Now that's the church meeting in the early century and still is today. Now in the next section, beginning with verse 27 and on through to almost the end of the chapter, the apostle is going to deal with three problem areas in the church. The exercise of three gifts which would create or tend to create certain problems. And we certainly have a parallel to this today. As you will note as we go through this, there's first the matter of tongues, the exercise of the gift of tongues, which as we saw last week is a matter of praising God in a language that was never learned. And since its content was praise and rejoicing and thanksgiving, it was basically an emotional experience. Now, if the meeting gets too heavily involved in that area, it turns it into an emotional meeting. And this is the problem yet today. One of the dangers we have is that meetings will become too centered in emotions. I've been in meetings where it was a kind of a riot of hand clapping and shouting and singing and raising hands and even dancing in the aisles. And it was a wild emotional time. And there are people today who think that that's the only kind of meeting that is of any value at all. They look forward to their weekly religious jag where they experience a kind of spiritual high to live on the rest of the week. Now, that's a problem, and Paul will deal with it here. And then there's the matter of prophesying. Prophesying is the expounding of the mind of God with application to the specific problems of the day. And it could tend, therefore, to a kind of over-theologizing, which would turn the meeting into heaviness and dullness and a profundity that would be over many people's heads. Therefore, excellent gift as prophesying was, it could be misused. And Paul is concerned about that. And there are meetings like that today as well. You perhaps will recognize, and some of you have experienced them. And then there was the matter of the freedom of women to minister in the church. We want to say more about that because this is a highly controversial passage. But as Paul will describe it, it tends to create sometimes a digression from the edifying process and creates debate and division and dissension, and that created a problem in the church. Now, we're not far removed from these today. It's evident that we can be lost in the mystical, in the theological, or in the dialectical, whichever can take over a meeting. And that's what Paul is anxious to avoid. Now, to do so, therefore, he suggests certain rules. Oh, you say, I don't like rules. They always tend to lay down heavy restrictions on people. Well, I don't like rules either. I basically resist rules. But I learned many years ago, as many of you have, that you can't function as a corporate body without some rules. You can't play a game of football without rules. It's the rules that make the game possible. You can't play a game of chess without rules. You can't drive through traffic without rules. It's the rules that enable you to enjoy and play the game. And so certain rules, fundamental rules, are necessary. And now the apostle turns to those. First, the matter of rules about tongues. If any speak in a tongue, let there be only two, or at the most three, and each in turn, and let one interpret. But if there is no one to interpret, let each of them keep silence in church and speak to himself and to God. Three simple limits govern the matter of the exercise of the biblical gift of tongues. First, only one or two, that's all. Only one or two. In very exceptional cases, at the most, the limit would be three. Now, why? Well, because it is an emotional experience. And too much emotion in a meeting is destructive. Too little is destructive, too. But this is why the apostles are earnest about trying to regulate that so it isn't too much of any good thing. And here he says, therefore, only one or two, and they must speak in order. There's to be no duplication or multiplicity of speakers speaking all at once, but it's that everyone enjoy the ministry of tongues as it's limited to one or two. Second, it must be interpreted. And he seems to imply that one of those who spoke in these unlearned languages would be given the gift of interpretation. So he says, let there be only two, or at the most three, and each in turn, and let one interpret. And without interpretation, it was not to be allowed or permitted. That's the third point. If no one is able to interpret, then no one is to speak in tongues in the church, because it must be interpreted for edification, as the apostle makes clear. And this is why he says, or seems to imply, that someone who speaks in a language like that ought to discover or examine whether someone has the ability to interpret before he does so. Or if there is no one, it should not be allowed. And if there's no one to interpret, then let him, as he says, speak to himself. That means to praise God in his spirit, in his thoughts, but not in words. and address himself to God in his thought life. Anyone can do that without disturbing a meeting, and so the apostle lays that upon them. Now he turns to rules concerning prophesying. And again, it's very simple. Let two or three prophets speak, and let the others weigh what is said. If a revelation is made to another sitting by, let the first be silent. For you can all prophesy one by one, so that all may learn and all be encouraged. And the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets. For God is not a God of confusion, but of peace. Once again, three simple controls. And remember now, he has in view the small home type of meeting, where probably no more than 10 or 12 people were present, or 20 or so at the most. And they could each take turns in this. But at any one meeting, it was to be limited to one or two, or again, at the most, three. And this was in order to prevent any lengthy meetings. When you prophesy, you tend to take a little longer time. That's because you're explaining things. Preachers are notorious for being long-winded, and this was therefore a limitation on the meeting. Some preachers have no terminal facilities, and it's necessary to control them by artificial means. For the apostle is well aware of the truth of the modern proverb, the mind can absorb only what the seat can endure. And so he was not allowing the meeting to go on in any protracted way. Then the second rule was that prophesying should be examined. Let the others weigh it, he said. Prophesying, you see, is an attempt to expound and explain the mind of God. And that's not subject. It isn't covered under inspiration. Everything a prophet says is not necessarily true. As Calvin said, it is the gift of explaining revelation. Therefore, it is subject to the judgment and comment of others. And in these small meetings, this was expected, that somebody who spoke as a prophet would be subjected to the confirmation and the correction, if necessary, of others who were present in the meeting. And therefore, these things were to be open to that kind of challenge. Now, the third limit was, let it be one by one, and if a revelation is made to another sitting by, let the first be silent. In other words, nobody was to take over the meeting. It wasn't to be a domination by any one person. And this was possible, Paul adds, for two reasons. Because the spirit of the prophets is subject to the prophets. Probably someone would feel like saying, well, I can't help what I say. The Spirit of God is in me, and He is speaking through me. And therefore, everything I say is of God, and I can't help myself. Paul says, rubbish. The Spirit of the prophet is subject to the prophet, and you can help yourself. And you needn't claim that you just have to say these things. As someone has said, there are always two kinds of speakers, those who say, who have something to say, and those who have to say something. And the apostle is concerned that he limit these others. The second reason he gives is God, the Spirit of God, never creates confusion or disorder. And therefore, no one is to dominate a meeting, run away with it, or consider himself an inspired spokesman, because God does not work that way. Let it be orderly and decently done, and give room to others to speak and to share in the ministry. And remember, if there's strife and jealousy and confusion and argument and that kind of thing, it's not a meeting led by the Spirit of God. God does not work that way. Where there's that kind of a meeting, it is something, some other spirit at work. That brought him then to the third major area of difficulty in the church, and that is the ministry of women. He says, and it's properly, the verse is properly divided here in verse 38, as in all the church, verse 33, I'm sorry, as in all the churches of the saints, the women should keep silence in the churches, for they are not permitted to speak, but should be subordinate as even the law says. If there's anything they desire to know, let them ask their husbands at home. For it is shameful for a woman to speak in church. What? Did the word of God originate with you? Or are you the only one it has reached? Now, it's this passage that has caused many people today to write off the Apostle Paul. They regard him as a bitter old bachelor who hated women and who is threatened by the exercise of any feminine gifts. But of course, that's a travesty on the character of the apostle. And it ignores many other pictures of Paul in the gospel, in the scriptures, and his relationship with women. It's clear from several accounts that there were certain women who traveled with the Apostle Paul in a small group of men and women who went around together with him to help him in his ministry in many ways. It's also clear from several accounts that the Apostle speaks of these individual women in the highest terms, with respect and with love and with warmth. And he praises them for their work and for their ministry. And to regard Paul as a woman-hater, hating bachelor, is indeed to miss the thrust of the scriptures in this regard. He has, in fact, in chapter 11 of this same letter, strongly defended the right of women to pray and prophesy in the church meeting. The only problem, he says, is they must give a recognition in some way that they recognize God's moral order of leadership, the principle of headship. And he's dealt with that at length in the 11th chapter. I'm not going to go back over that again. No, you see, the problem here is not a woman ministering in the church at all. That was proper. Despite the traditional interpretation of these events in the last two centuries. No, the problem was still, as the context makes clear, one of disorder and confusion. That was what was the problem. And it probably grew out of the very freedom that women did have to minister in the church at Corinth. Both the Greek, the Jewish community, and to a large degree the Greek community, put down the ministry of women. Certainly the Jews did. They didn't allow it at all. But here in a Christian church, women were permitted to minister under the recognition of the principle of headship. And as a consequence, some of them undoubtedly went too far. This is a normal human tendency within all of us. They run away with freedom, and this some were doing. And as this clearly suggests, therefore, they were asking questions and entering into debate on some of the issues that were being talked about and discussed in the meeting, and they were turning it into a discussion group and into a debate. And some, as Paul has indicated earlier, had abandoned the head covering, which in the city of Corinth was a sign that they did indeed appreciate and recognize the leadership order that God had instituted. And they were thus creating not only dissension, but as he indicates here, a shameful situation. People in the city who were not Christians were laughing at these Christians, or disregarding their word because of the violation in this regard. Now that's what the apostle is concerned about. I think it's confirmed by his choice of words here. You notice he doesn't say it is forbidden or for women to minister in the church. He doesn't say that. Nor does he say, is it forbidden for women to prophesy or to pray or to teach? None of that is the term that he employed. It's the very common word, speak. It is forbidden, he says, the women should keep silence. They are not permitted to speak. And there the word is laleo, which is the commonest word for simply conversation. Talking, that's all. And that was the problem. I think we could well interpret it even with the word, English word, chatter. This was what was going on. Women were entering in and talking it over, and they got carried away. And they sometimes turned the meeting into kind of an open chatterbox. And especially because they were exercising a freedom that they rightly possess. Now, it's well known that garrulousness is a quality more frequently perhaps found in women than in men. Now, men can be loose-tongued and run off at the mouth, too. I've met some of them. But women often have this problem. You know, remember the story of the woman who was rebuked for talking too much, and she said, well, how can I know what I think if I haven't heard what I have to say? But the place, obviously, Paul says, for extensive, wordy discussion about these matters is at home. Let her ask her husband at home. You come to my house when we're involved in a theological discussion, and you'll see exactly what the apostle means. It goes on for hours, upstairs and downstairs, and then it's broken off for a while, and then we pick it up again at the table, and it goes on for a long time, and that's the right place for it. My wife has a keen theological mind, which I greatly appreciate, and we have some very interesting discussions on these matters. And that's where it ought to be, Paul says, these lengthy discussions and debates over this, but not in the church meeting. That doesn't edify. That gets off the track. That digresses from the purpose and focus of the meeting, and that's what he's warning against. Now, in verses 36 through 38, he anticipates the reaction of many. What? Did the Word of God originate with you, or are you the only ones it has reached? That's clearly satire. And he is recognizing that there was a tendency among some in Corinth to think that they had unique revelation, special gifts that no one else had. And Paul treats it in this rather sarcastic way with this kind of language. Did the Word of God originate with you, or are you the only ones who received it? It almost sounds like dear old Job with his three comforters, when he said, verily, you are the people, and wisdom will die with you. And people have a tendency sometimes to assume this. I remember my dear patron saint, Dr. H.A. Ironside, telling me of an encounter he had with a woman who came up to him after a meeting in which he had spoken on 1 Corinthians 6:11, where Paul says to the Corinthians, such were some of you, but you are washed, you are sanctified, you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus. And after the meeting, a lady came up and she said, you got those words mixed up. They're in the wrong order. You put sanctification before justification. And everyone knows that justification comes first, and then you're sanctified. And the apostle, or rather, Dr. Ironside. You know, he was called the apostle of fundamentalism for a while. He said to her, well, I was simply quoting the apostle Paul. Oh, she said, that couldn't be. He would never have done that. Well, he said, here's the passage. And he turned to it and opened it up, read it to her, had her read it, and she read it. But you are washed, you are sanctified, you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus. And she handed it back to him and said, well, Paul couldn't have been very clear on the doctrine of holiness if he wrote that. Well, you see, there are some people that assume that they have the original meaning and the original inspiration of Scripture. They're even set aside the Scripture to sustain that. Then Paul says, if anyone thinks that he is a prophet or spiritual, he should acknowledge that what I am writing to you is a command of the Lord. In other words, the truly spiritual people always recognize the authority of the Scripture. And this is very important in these days, where people are claiming to be led of the Spirit. And when you point out from a passage of Scripture that what they're saying is contrary to it, they still insist on their feeling or their experience or their understanding as superior to that of the Word of God. Now, Paul says that's not true. The Spirit of God never operates contrary to the written Word. Never. And anyone who is truly Spirit-minded and Spirit-filled will recognize the authority of the Word of God. Always. And then the third thing he says to them is in verse 38. If anyone does not recognize this, he is not recognized. Literally, it's, if anyone be ignorant, let him be ignored. In other words, don't pay attention to him. Don't needlessly exalt him or her and even get engaged in a lengthy debate about it. It's paying too much attention to it. Best way to handle it is just ignore them. If they won't listen to the authority of the Word, then just don't give them a place where they can, a platform from which to speak. Just ignore them. And then he closes with a gathering up, a gathering statement of his final words. So, my brethren, earnestly desire to prophesy, and do not forbid speaking in tongues, but all things should be done decently and in order. And that's been the thrust of the whole passage, hasn't it? Choose prophesying, he says. It will build people up. It will comfort them. It will strengthen them. It will edify them. Therefore, that's the supreme ministry when the church comes together. And don't forbid speaking in tongues. He has, of course, the true biblical gift in view. No one knows whether there won't come in an unbeliever who perhaps needs the exercise of a gift like this. And God is sovereign and he has the right to exercise and to give gifts as he pleases. So don't forbid that. But if it is the true biblical gift, it will have the effect that the Scripture suggests of being a sign to unbelievers. However, if it's not the true biblical gift, if it is what, as we have suggested in a previous message, is a psychological phenomenon, which is commonly mistaken for the biblical gift of tongues, and there's reason to think it that that's the manifestation, then there's every right to forbid it in a church, because it can be a very divisive and destructive thing. But in all things, he says, let everything be done decently and in order. God is a God of order. Therefore, when the church comes together, it can be built up in marvelous ways. It can be such a strengthening thing to meet together and to encourage one another in our faith and to share in the exercise of spiritual gifts and to be taught by the mind of God, by the Spirit of God, through the Word of God, and to be comforted in times of trial and testing and pressure. This is a purpose for the church getting together. But whatever you do, don't let it become just an endlessly confusing and misrepresentative ministry, misrepresentative of the character of God. He's the God of order and decency.
Do whatever you want to. I will make room. mistakes, but you have new mercy for me every day. Your love never fails. Sing it, you stay.
Your hands and sing it, you make you.